Welcome back, everyone. Today we're going to be contrasting plant and animal cells. A lot of videos cover the different organelles, but this video does that and compares how the different cell types tackle the same problems. At the end, we'll also be organizing all that information into a handy chart that makes a great study reference, so be sure to stick with us. The first task we're going to discuss is how cells maintain an internal environment that's different than their external environment. Both plant and animal cells use a selectively permeable membrane that's composed of two layers of phospholipids and studded with channels. These channels only allow certain molecules to pass through and thus play a major role in regulating the internal environment. Plant and animal cells both use a selectively permeable membrane. To store and pass on genetic information, both plant and animal cells use a nucleus and a nucleolus. The nucleus contains genetic information that controls growth, cellular activity, and protein creation. The nucleolus assembles components of ribosomes, which play an important role in protein creation. When it comes to creating proteins, ribosomes string together amino acids with peptide bonds. Even though they're really important, ribosomes are technically not considered to be organelles because they're not membrane-bound. The Golgi apparatus then takes this long polypeptide chain created by the ribosomes and folds it up into a protein. Plant and animal cells need to be able to move the proteins around the cell. The endoplasmic reticulum assists with transport and also plays several other roles depending on whether it is rough or smooth. The rough endoplasmic reticulum is studded with ribosomes so that it can aid in protein synthesis. It also attaches instructional tags to polypeptides. The smooth ER participates in lipid synthesis, stores ions, and aids in detoxification. So the next time you survive drinking an alcoholic beverage, definitely thank your smooth ER. So far, plant and animal cells have tackled their problems in very similar ways, but here's where we're going to start to diverge a little bit. Both cell types use vacuoles for storage, but they differ in the specifics. Plant cells have a large central vacuole, and when it's full, it helps to provide support to the cell by creating turgor pressure. This is why if you forget to water a plant for a few days, it gets all droopy and wilts, but if you water it, it tends to perk right back up. Animal cells can have either many small vacuoles or none at all, and they only use them for storage rather than support. Plant and animal cells continue to differ in terms of how they obtain energy. Both cell types are capable of undergoing cellular respiration, which they perform using mitochondria. Most of the time, plants perform photosynthesis in order to harvest energy from the sun. However, they do cellular respiration when they're only seedlings and don't have any leaves yet. Animal cells can't photosynthesize at all, so they use cellular respiration to obtain energy. Scientists believe that both chloroplasts and mitochondria were originally bacteria that were ingested by early cells. We call this the endosymbiotic theory. Both plant and animal cells use mitosis for somatic cells and meiosis for sex cells. Each cell type has specializations that assist with the division process. Animal cells have centrioles that initiate spindle fiber formation. Plants don't have centrioles, but they do have vesicles that deliver cell wall components along the cell plate. This separates the newly forming cells. When it comes to maintaining cell shape, plant and animal cells have very different strategies. Plants use their large central vacuole to create turgor pressure and use that in conjunction with their supportive cell walls. The cell walls are usually made of cellulose, which is what makes plants crunchy. Animal cells are more squishy, so they rely on a protein scaffolding called the cytoskeleton. The cytoskeleton is produced by organelles called centrosomes, which my students always say look like churros. I totally agree, but they're probably a lot less delicious. All living things produce waste, but plant and animal cells have different methods for getting rid of it. In animal cells, enzyme-filled sacs called lysosomes degrade waste products. They also perform a process called exocytosis, where a waste-filled vesicle docks up against the cell membrane and releases its contents. Plants don't have lysosomes, but they can release gases via transpiration through their stomata, and they can also use enzymes called proteases to degrade proteins, although these are not well understood. Finally, cell-to-cell communication presents some unique challenges for each cell type. Plants often communicate through plasmodesmata, tiny channels in the cell wall, but because animal tissues are so diverse, they need multiple methods of communication. A few examples include endocytosis, exocytosis, and gap junctions, although the details are outside the scope of this video. Okay, that was definitely a lot of content, so here's a recap. Plant and animal cells are very different from one another, but also have a lot of processes in common. They maintain their internal environment, store and pass on genetic information, create proteins, and move items around the cell in much the same way. They also contain organelles that allow them to store items and obtain energy in related ways. When it comes time to divide, maintain cell shape, remove waste, or communicate from cell to cell, plants and animals require different organelles to get the job done. That's it for this week. If you found this video useful, I hope you'll consider checking out some of my other work or looking at some of my other materials on Twitter and Instagram. Thanks again for watching, and please remember to subscribe.